I will talk on R&D and applications of the emulsion detectors in Switzerland. Sorry. This one. Okay. So the one of Swiss emulsion activity is a large contribution in the OPERA experiment. The OPERA is aiming at direct detection of neutrino oscillation in the appearance mode using some tuberous of neutrino beam. And the OPERA detector consists of about 9 times 10 to 6 emulsion films. This is the biggest ever enterprise in the emulsion experiments. So exploiting the know-how for next experiment, we are conducting R&D on emulsion technology and some other physics applications. First, I show Swiss scanning station. We have 6 microscopes with automatic plate changers in some clean rooms. The scanning and tracking speed is for 5 microscopes for OPERA is 20 square centimeter per hour per microscope. And we have 6 microscopes for R&D. This is faster, and you will see in the talk by Akitaka Ariga. So we are treating several hundred of emulsion sheets per week. This laboratory is the second OPERA emulsion scanning laboratory in the world and first in Europe. So the strong advantage of our group for the R&D is all infrastructures available in Bern or in Switzerland. So for film production, it's done in an underground laboratory 30 meters deep. And for the performance check of the detectors, we have electron and proton in the hospital in Bern. It's available for our daily check, and also a 2.5 MeV neutron source is available in our group. Or we can also use SAM and PSI for the performance check. Then we have also development facility and the scanning station as already shown. Here I show the underground emulsion facility. This is in 30 meter deep with low cosmic ray flux. And the laboratory was refurbished in 2013. We have more space and equipment. So for pulling, we are using gel from Nagoya University in Japan and also sometimes Slavich in Russia. We have several pulling tables with high precision and with vacuum system, and we are implementing temperature control. Also the development facility. Then some other equipment like for cryogenic tests, vacuum systems, sub-dark room, blah, blah. We had some studies on the best treatment for both plastic base and for glass base. For plastic base, we have a chemical treatment which somehow worked, and we are now investigating to use corona discharge to make it stronger. For glass base, we are using the whey from Dubna, This is a development in the framework of the INET project, Switzerland and Russia. We thanks to Russian colleagues. So for the emulsion film production, for burning we are using gel from Nagoya and Slavic. And the film has multi-layer structure. The basic type is like this. In this case, using plastic base of 70 micron to about 400 microns. We have layer of base treatment and the emulsion layer with we are using 50 to 150 micron and with protection layer. This is the result of sensitivity evaluation of produced film in 2011 for MIP using sound test beams. This is a difference of current opera film like brain density 30 and fog density 10. And this is a new film we made with Nagoya gel. With developing time 20 minutes, grain density 48 and fog density 1.9. And this is Slavic gel 2011. We worked with our Russian colleagues with opera developer and 10 minutes. Grain density was 33 and fog density 5. Okay. Here I show an example of irradiation with 22 MeV electrons available in our university. Then here we tested three kinds of Nagoya gel with ADPR ratio 30, 45, 55, and we had a grain density like this at about 59 at AGBR 55%. Then we had a measurement of intrinsic resolution of new films using a high energy track and evaluated the deviation of each grain from the fitted line. And this histogram shows the result, and the sigma was 58 nanometer, which is similar to the opera of 50 nanometer. This is an example of irradiation with 18 MeV protons available at the beam transfer line of the new Bern cyclotron laboratory. You can see clear proton tracks. This beam is useful for our daily check of emulsion distortion study and the particle identification by DDX and the stopping points. So the emulsion technology consists of hardware detector production, development, and scanning. It's now available for the several applications. While in the physics applications, we opera T2K and the Aegis will be explained later. And the accelerator like beam monitoring, and for medical application we are working on neutron dosimetry, proton radiography, and beam characterization in proton therapy, and also muon radiography in geosciences. So the possible next biggest challenge is the Aegis experiment. This is a measurement for the measurement of gravitational force on antimatter. So you will see the talk by the next talk on this experiment. So I just say there are several requirements for the emulsion detectors, like absolute position resolution over 10 centimeter or 20 centimeter surface, and emulsion in vacuum and at low temperature like 77 Kelvin. Here I just show the picture of test run in 2012. The left is annihilation vertex in opera film and annihilation vertex in new film made with Nagoya gel. Okay, so you will see the next talk. And I introduce another application. This is the absolute muon flux measurement at muon pit in the T2K experiment. So this is, we placed the emulsion hand detector after beam lamp behind of the muon monitor detector. We can measure the absolute flux and angular and momentum distributions of muons, and then compare distribution with beam Monte Carlo to validate hadron production models. Okay. Then we have the comparison with Monte Carlo on absolute muon flux. This is the result in 2010. We compared with two kinds of Monte Carlo, Zikalawa and Fluka. At that time, data was between the two Monte Carlos, and recently they updated Monte Carlo using and tuned by the result of NA61 experiment. So now we can see the good agreement, and the data was useful to validate this result. Also, we can do comparison on the like momentum distribution. Okay. Then the analysis will be finished soon. Another application is in the field of medical application, and this time is for neutron spectroscopy with emulsions. The secondary neutrons in clinical proton radiotherapy is a crucial issue for possible secondary cancer induction, and it is important to assess and minimize the potential of second cancer induction. So we are investigating the possibility of using the emulsion film to characterize the neutron fields. So we can measure neutron energy spectrum and angular information, or neutron source imaging using angular information. This is one test, neutron exposure at cell facility in SAM. Judged hadron beam coming this way, and there is kappa target, and there is concrete shield, and we had the emulsion detectors around here. Here you can see some of selected tracks in 120 plates of a module. Here we had to compare the, and this is a reconstructed proton energy distribution for data black point and green with Monte Carlo. And this is the same for angular distribution. We had rather good agreement on this. Using this information, now trying to unfold the neutron spectrum, it's ongoing. Then this is another exposure to construct low energy neutron. Here we used 2.5 MeV neutrons from the diffusion, and decoil proton range is about 70 micron. Okay, here you can see some proton tracks. This is a study of imaging of neutron source by using angular information of recoiled protons. Now the automatic tracking for short track is available and the analysis is ongoing. There are some other applications like muon radiography. There was a test in Vancouver here. This was for 3D reconstruction of mineral deposits in Vancouver mine, Canada. For these explosions, we had problem in evaluating uncertainty of efficiency, and we clearly need good quality film for next trials. There are also further plans for mountains in Switzerland to check the like water contents and so on. So summary, at Helperon, we are conducting an intensive R&D program on emulsion detectors for a wide range of applications. Infrastructures for R&D are available in Perm. And the high sensitivity detector production has been established, and rich applications in many fields are ongoing, like EGIS and medical applications. Thank you. And currently, JEL is from Nagoya or Russia, and we are performing film production.
For the video, this is for the hope. You put it in the pocket.
Both of them?
Yeah, it's okay. You need to keep it closer to you.
Okay, so I will report the AGIS experiment. So what I understood today is people are coming from very different field, but using emulsion. Maybe if you have some question, it's better ask, stop me and just ask, it's better. And now, we are working for the AGIS experiment. This is to measure a fundamental question about gravity for antimatter. It's same for gravity for matter. So anti-apple, for same way as normal apple. We are going to answer this question in a few years. Then motivation, why we study antimatters. Then principle of equivalence between gravitational and inertial mass is a foundation of general relativity. In general relativity, this is classical theory, and there's no distinction between matter and antimatter. So standard general relativity, matter and antimatter should act same. For the universality of a free fall is tested up to 10 to minus 12 directly. but only with matter-based experiment. Then we don't know antimatter really acts same as matter. We proposed AGES experiment. This is a test of universality of free fall with antimatter by measuring Earth's gravitational acceleration on the beam of hydrogen, anti-hydrogen. Then this is a collaboration about 15 institutes are inside. Then the how we measure the free fall of anti-hydrogen is this. So we produce anti-hydrogen, and we have two set of the slits we call Moiré flux meters. Then by putting two slits, we should have a pattern of periodic pattern of the vertices of annihilations, anti-hydrogen annihilations. So here we place free fall detector, position sensitive detector. In this case, we use emulsion. So the order of free fall is about 10 microns. It's very small. So other than detectors, other than emulsion, cannot measure this free fall. So emulsion was a natural choice for this experiment. Then this is a sensitivity. So this is a phase in period. If we use 1 micron sensitivity detector, we'll have a very strong signal like this. And if we have a 10 micron resolution detector, the significance is less. So this is number of anti-hydrogen detected. Oh, sorry, I forgot to say. In this experiment, goal is 1% resolution for delta G over G. And for this, we need a good resolution. So this is number of anti-hydrogen detected needed to reach this goal. So with a few micron precision detector, we can reach 1% precision with 100 anti-hydrogen interactions. I think everybody knows how anti-hydrogen looks like. So I skip. And this is AGES apparatus. So anti-proton will come from upstream, and positron come like this. And here we trap anti-proton and cooling down and move to here to form anti-hydrogen. And then this region is cooled down to 4 Kelvin. And we form anti-hydrogen in this trap and then accelerate them to the flight region where emulsion is placed. This is the status of the AGES apparatus. This is 5 Tesla magnet and 1 Tesla magnet, and here you can see the trap is installed. And this one, we are also working for the annihilation detector using fiber trackers, and this is installed here. It's very complicated and different from emulsion techniques. Then there's many numbers of technical challenges. We have to operate emulsion in vacuum. So we don't have so much experience before. And emulsion can damage emulsion surface like this. This is first trial. So we pour the emulsion on glass base, and we put emulsion in vacuum for 2 days. Then the emulsion surface is completely destroyed. not only destruction, vacuum will increase fog, and we have to solve it.
What is the reason for this?
Lack of moisture, mainly.
Dry.
Yes. It's dry too much, and elasticity, immersion with elasticity. And also, we have to work at the low temperature, helium, liquid nitrogen temperature, and this, there is a little experience. And we need to scan tracks and with so the tracks from anti-hydrogen annihilation is low energy and also emitted in 4-pi steradian. So we need a very good scanning algorithm to detect all particles. Then some result for the immersion in vacuum is here. So the reason is the water loss by vacuum make this. Then there's two ways to avoid cracks established. One way is mix glycerin to the gel. Then we can keep elasticity in the immersion surface. Then we can avoid cracks. Or put some gas barrier film on immersion surface. This is a picture of the gas barrier films with aluminum vapor deposition tape. If we cover with this tape, there is no cracks. And the part we didn't covered by tape is destructive. Then we checked noise increase in vacuum. Then losing of moisture also makes mechanical stress by and increase random fog. This is not direct contact. There is some glue between immersion and aluminum. And this is order of 2 days. In 2 days, problem is reduced. So in the vacuum, mechanical stress can make a random fog. And this is studied. So if we don't add, so this is a x-axis is a glycerin content in the gel. And if there's no glycerin inside, the fog density is much bigger than 60 grains per 10 by 10 by 10 micron cubic. But if we add the glycerin, the fog density is decreased. And adding glycerin solve fog increase problem and also crack problem. So this is one of the promising method for the vacuum. Then we check the sensitivity of glycerin added glycerin treated films with high energy pions. Then we place the several days in the vacuum and check the sensitivity of the crystals. So adding glycerin for sure we lose some grain density because glycerin is additionally occupy some volume. But we check the sensitivity of crystal itself, then this is a number of detection efficiency of MIP tracks per crystal. Then this will kept same for even we add glycerin solution. So even if we added glycerin, the sensitivity of crystal doesn't change. Okay. Coming to the low temperature test, we made a temperature variable cryostat to test sensitivity at low temperature. So this is a vacuum vessel with a copper finger, copper block, and one side of copper is connected to the liquid nitrogen. Then we place immersion here and control temperature with heater and PC. And this is a picture. This copper block and immersion is here. And then we export the beta ray. And this is a picture at the room temperature. You can see clear beta ray tracks. And liquid nitrogen temperature, the tracks are getting faint. So sensitivity at low temperature is lower in the liquid nitrogen temperature case, but still you can see the tracks clearly. Now here we are using high sensitivity immersion gel provided by Nagoya University. Then this is the sensitivity at low temperature. X-axis is the temperature and the y-axis is grain density, number of grains per 100 micron. And the blue one is a high sensitivity gel and the film produced by ourselves. And the green one is a conventional opera film. So at room temperature, the sensitivity is about 50 grains per 100 micron, and it is reduced about 32 grains at liquid nitrogen temperature. And same feature is observed for the opera film. So opera film is 28 or 30, then here 18 grains per 100 micron. The reduction seems the same. And the mechanism of reduction of sensitivity is there is several hypotheses, but it is not clear. But it seems for two crystals, they are same. So even at liquid nitrogen temperature, we have more than 30 grains per 100 micron. So this is enough for MIP tracking, and we say we can work with this temperature. Okay, coming to some fun. So we did the commissioning in 2012 with test prototype chamber. So this is a Aegis beamline. So this is end of Aegis beamline. We placed a kind of vacuum chamber here, attached here, and inside vacuum chamber, immersion is supported with metal piece. Then we got antiproton annihilation directly on the immersion surface. You can see clear stars here and there.
This is already anti-hydrogen
beam. This is antiproton beam. Anti-hydrogen is much more difficult. Okay. You are very familiar with the immersion track. Other people in Aegis and other community is not familiar with immersion data. So this is a vertex in the image is processed, and you can see very clear pictures. So people. Non-emergionist people is very happy with this picture. And this is a three-dimensional view of the same event. So you can see the heavy energy deposit in the star, and there's many tracks coming out of the vertex. We analyze the data of the antiproton annihilations. So this is observed angular distributions. we scanned, this is a sample of opera film, 5 centimeter by 5 centimeter. We reconstructed millions of tracks, and most of them are small angle. Zero and zero means a vertical to the immersion film, beam direction. They are mostly background pions, and there's strong peak in position is observed. So other than this peak is tracks from annihilation. And you can see the support structure, this cross structure in the immersion film. This is 5 by 5 centimeters. Then this is some physics result from commissioning. We measured multiplicity of produced tracks in the anti-proton interactions. So interestingly, there is no data of anti-proton annihilation in the matter or fragmentation data. It doesn't exist in the world, apart from textbook from Powell or very 70s. So it is interesting to compare recent knowledge in the giant force simulation or recent models. So this cross data from our commissioning, only 100 interactions in this data sample, but still we can say recent model chips and Fritjof two models in Jant 4, we can compare with them. So this is for all tracks, and this is a minimum ionizing track and heavy ionizing tracks. So from there, we can say this red color, which is called CHIPS model, is better agreement with our data. And blue one, Fritjof data, Monte Carlo model is not good for us. These are important to tune our Monte Carlo in ages experiment, and also interesting for fundamental knowledge of annihilations. One interesting point is even, sorry, I didn't add. This is a annihilation directory on inside immersion. And there's a difference. We also checked annihilation between several metals. So we placed aluminum, copper, silicon, titanium, or silver, gold. So this is a result from preliminary result from the recent study. So the conclusion is none of model agrees with our data. So this is something interesting. We are studying something new. So we are going, and we have more data coming. Okay. So coming back to the main purpose of AGES experiment. So we, as I said, there is a two slit. We place two slit, and then we should see the periodic pattern on nuclear immersion films. Then to prove this, we made a test module. This is a support structure of this two gratings, Moore gratings. And pitch is 40 microns. Every 40 microns, there is opening of silicon. And then here, we should see the periodic pattern. And this is data from annihilation vertex. And on the right side, okay, this is 2.5 millimeter and 6 millimeters. On the right, I draw the 40 micron pitch. Then from here, you don't see periodic pattern, but by a special algorithm, we can see a clear periodic pattern inside. So here, this is a rotation between the support structure and the emulsion film, and this is a pitch of gratings. So, there is a strong peak at 40 micron as expected, and we can, from this we can say we could see the periodic pattern. And by folding this 40.2 micron, we could see the distribution like this. So we should see kind of sine pattern here, and we saw it. So we could prove the principle of experiment. Okay. Then this is completely another subject. So we are opening our data to the public, and this is to open opportunity for general public to analyze emulsion data. Then amateur physicists can join our analysis with PC and internet. So this is so tomorrow you will hear a lot of talks about high speed tracking computing, but this is the opposite way. This is to ask amateur physicists for manual check, eye scanning, ask to be a scanner for you. Then we did a prototype study for 2 days in framework of SAN or open science program. Then this is for manual check of the Aegis film of 100 views, and then in 2 days, 700 participants from all over the world were joined. And this is a distribution of participants in the world, mostly Europe and US, and some from Asia and others. Then in few hours, all 100 views are analyzed by amateur physicists. And so if you need manual check, we can ask the amateur physicists in the world, they are we call crowdsourcing. This is another way of open scanning system to the people. Okay, that's all. And summary, so we are going to measure gravitational force on antimatter is a fundamental question in understanding our universe. And this experiment is going to measure for the first time. Then we employ emulsion for the free fall detector, and there is a rich physics byproduct of antiproton annihilation studies. And many technical challenges, but we are overcoming this, and we did the successful commissioning in 2012. We continue R&D this year, next year, and we will have a physics run in 2015. That's all. One micron. Yes, this is a challenge task. Yes.
So, which kind of calibration are you going to do? Because we are not with MOSFETs and also.
No. Emulsion. Well, so we are only one in emulsion lab, and we think this is in principle okay. What do you mean? Yeah, that's why, first of all, we cannot use conventional plastic base films. Because the plastic base is so soft and it's not reliable. We use glass base and with hard glass base.
In principle, it is interesting to see in emulsions anti-neutrons, and maybe you charge, you can have a charge exchange process when you have anti-protons. And such models were developed, I remember, in the 80s, that in annihilation of anti-nucleon to produce few fines. And the fines make produce fragmentation. Such models were developed, but forgot. Multi-pion interaction inside progress. But also interesting, if possible, because anti-neutron was discovered, as you know, as annihilation in lead glass. And to expose emulsion to anti-neutrons, it is maybe also interesting.
Yes. This is one, and this is two. No, no, you must.
I need to wear this too. This is for the camera, for the film. You can put it in your pocket.
No. Ah, sorry, sorry. Never.
Okay.
Two microphones.
Yeah, one is for the room, and one is for the camera.
Ah, I see.
Thank you.
Maybe. Maybe not necessary microphone for hall. Enough my voice. Well, I would like to present report about our work connected with search for the super heavy elements in galactic cosmic rays. But before discuss this problem, I would like to remember that today we plan to discuss a future of nuclear track detector method. And it seems for me that very important to remember about our base, which we use in our investigation. So, sorry, a few words about our history. Of course, all participant meeting today knows that track detectors registration of elementary particles is accompanied by a visual track which repeat trajectory of elementary particles. Such kind of track detector like bubble, spark chamber, nuclear emulsion and some other has large using in physics in the world. The popularity and long life of the track detection technique are connected with some merits of this method, and maybe one of the main is high spatial resolution. The track detector techniques has great meaning really for nuclear physics, and the confirmation of this fact there are some Nobel Prize. Short list of such Nobel Prize which connected with track detector technique. Becquerel, 1903. Wilson Cloud Chamber, 1927. Next Nobel Prize, Victor Hess, 1936. He used not only stroboscope but also photo layers. Of course, 1950 Powell, which made a lot of work for creation for the emulsion method. Next Nobel Prize, 1960, Glaser, invention of cloud chamber. 1968, Alvarez, discovery of resonance states. using hydrogen bubble chamber and also Sharpak 1994 using for multi-wire proportional chamber. This is our great history, and we continue development of this technique, and all of them hope for our future so interesting result like our teachers and scientists which work before us. Few words about Lebedev activity connected with nuclear track detector. In our group, we use this technique more than 30 years. One of our experiments was connected with balloon experiment. We investigate composition of primary cosmic ray and first organize international Russian China balloon flight in 1990. Also, one of our important work, our CERN experiment EMU-15, when we investigate lead-lead interaction with very high density and temperature at CERN. And we, in this experiment, after treatment nuclear emulsion, we recognize presence of unusual structure in secondary charged particle distribution. You see on the top such example of target diagrams, our experimental event. We can recognize easy ring-like structure in secondary particle distribution. Bottom figure demonstrate some model calculation for equal multiplicity of events. It was very interesting results, and many groups check also data for search such events. Namely, starting our work in frame of EMU-15 experiment, we should solve problem of automated measurement and nuclear emulsion. In 2000 years, in Lebedev Physical Institute was created a completely automated measurement facility, PVCOM. This facility, first of automated microscope, was created under the leadership Professor Feinberg, and Maria today demonstrates this photo. Professor Feinberg was a brilliant scientist, and we create our first facility microscope under his leadership. Next slide, I would like to show our colleagues, which not simple visit our facility, but practically with we have joint cooperation and joint experiment with all person, which you can see in this figure. Also Maria, our scientist from Institute of Theoretical and Experimental Physics, Institute of Nuclear Research, also foreign scientist, you see Lucia Vatana, Antonio Ireditate, Masahiro Nakamura, Ariga-san, we was very glad to meet him in Lebedev Institute, and Giovanni Dalilis, his last visit in September last year in our group. We work practically with all possible types of track detector. I mean origin film, nuclear emulsion, CR39, and crystal and glass, practically all kind of such track detectors. Today, in this report, I would like to say about search for super heavy element in galactic cosmic ray. This problem is connected with possibility of existence of super heavy element Iceland, so called Iceland. In this picture, you see Mendeleev periodical system in axis neutron number and proton number. Colors mean lifetime of different nuclei. Green color means that such kind of nuclei live 1 second up to 1 year. Brown color means that such nuclei live 1 year up to 10 to the 9 years. And after uranium should be so-called stability island of superheavy element. This is prediction of theory. So during all physics history, in accelerator prepare and successfully execute experiment on artificial element synthesis. In 1969, in Mendeleev periodical system was 33 elements. In 2012, 118. JINR, Joint Institute Nuclear Research, is one of the world leaders in this direction. And you see that 12 artificial element was successfully created in Dubna. Last year, two this element received name Florevi and Livermory as confirmation large role of this laboratory. This work, creation of artificial element, has not only fundamental meaning, but also large practical results. For example, plutonium, this element, is nuclear fuel better quality even than uranium. And now production of synthetic elements in the world grows from billion part of gram up to many kilograms, even tons. But in case if such super heavy element should be exist, we can recognize it in nature. And one of question in what place we should try to search such element, and answer is of course cosmic ray. Cosmic ray, namely meteorite, because meteorite are natural detectors which have many millions a year of exposition time. Use of factor of long time exposure of meteorite in space led to great advantages of this method as compared to other. Florev evaluates that in consideration of great meteorite ages, investigation of 1 cubic centimeter of olivine crystal from meteorite is equal experiment with 1 ton of emulsion in the space during 1 year. First investigation of such heavy element was carried out in 1964, and the most detailed results was published by Vladimir Perelygin in period 1975-2003. We work with a sample of two meteorites, Maria Lahti, a piece of meteorite, Maria Lahti and Eagle Station. Age of Maria Lahti is 185 million year, Eagle Station 300 million year. You see that Eagle Station, this our piece of meteorite, consists of a semi-transparent olivine crystal included in iron around the olivine crystal. We destroyed meteorite, take out olivine, and try to search track of nuclei. We work in very close cooperation with Dubna, and you see here one of our working discussion with Professor Aganisyan, and this one is our colleagues, Dr. Leonid Kashkarov, because we work this experiment in cooperation with Vernadsky Geochemistry Institute. Unfortunately, I'm sorry, I cannot to mention this fact. Leonid Kashkarov died recently, September 27. He was a brilliant scientist, and maybe many of you can meet with him in international conference because he has very active scientific work. Unfortunately, he died, but we believe that our continuation of this experiment will be the best memory for Leonid Kashkarov. Well, as concerned again about statistics, world statistics of super heavy elements is not so high, only few tens of nuclei. And you see here main results received by Perelygin, Vladimir Perelygin, three nuclei with a charge 110. Professor Ginzburg, Nobel Prize, scientist from Lebedev Physical Institute, considered problem of superheavy nuclei search as one of the most important problem of modern physics. He included this problem to his famous list of first priority physical tasks. And you see, starting 2005 years, we published proposal of our experiment together with Professor Ginzburg, and we start investigation of galactic cosmic rays in olivine crystal. Again, the same piece of Eagle Station. We take out, we destroyed meteorite, take out olivine and mount it in epoxy table for measurement track parameter on microscope. Main principle which allows us to recognize charge of nuclei connected with dependence of ionization loss on energy of nuclei. You see here few curves. The bottom curve connected with energy loss of iron, and top curve connected with energy loss of uranium. You see that in case if a charge of nuclei is larger, this nuclei will have more longer track in olivine crystal. This figure explain unusual character of nuclei track, which we can see in olivine, such form. This is a figure, few nuclei in olivine, which we receive in our automated facility. And we use software for recognition parameter of these tracks. This one results of software treatment, and Dr. Starkov will inform more detail in his report about features of this software. Also, software created in our group allows us to see continuation track when we go in depths of the crystal. We firstly, our group are first, which use new principle, new method for etching and measurement track in olivine. Method of stepwise cut and etching. It means that we etch some depths in olivine and measure all parameter. After that, cut off part of olivine layers and go inside the crystal. So we have possibility to investigate all volume of crystal. Nobody before us don't use such method. But main problem is connected with small size of olivine pieces, not larger than 2 millimeters. So measurement only track length is not enough, because track is more longer. For example, uranium has track and olivine with length about 3 centimeters, size of our crystal 2 millimeters. So we use a second parameter for measurement charge, etching rate, and we plan to use third parameter, etching channel width, and I told few words about this possibility. Because we use calculation dependence for measurement charge of nuclei, of course it is necessary calibration experiment for us, and we made such calibration program. We continue this program, but also we have some results received on Darmstadt heavy iron accelerator. We calibrate our crystal and check our result of our model calculation using helium nuclei tracks and compare experimental track length with model length. Also, we made such calibration for aurum with such energy, and we received good agreement. And the same calibration was made for uranium. In this year, we start a new stage of our investigation connected with more detailed measurement of track structure. Namely, we use now electronic microscope for investigation parameter nuclei inside olivine crystal. You see this in this slide photo, some part of electronic microscope, and this photo demonstrate track from uranium. You see in this direction and this direction thin lines. This is olivine crystal structure, real olivine crystal structure, and we can see and measure directly structure of crystal destroying size 10 nanometers. So this picture received before etching. We start this work, we continue, and I hope that next nearest future we can inform about this new results. So finally, today we use two parameter, etching rate and length of track. Using such a three-dimensional surface, we can measure charge of nuclei in olivine crystal. Results of our measurement demonstrate in this picture as compared with data other experiment, Hiao and Ariel. This both this experiment was satellite electronic experiment, and you see good agreement between our data with data of this experiment. But as compared to this experiment, we have statistics with more heavy nuclei. Besides the distribution of galactic nuclei, we observed three events with charge more than 105. Very large track length, about 700-900 micron, and also very large etching rate, 35 millimeters. I would like to remember that maximum etching rate for uranium is 25 microns per hour. You see here, one of these super heavy track in olivine crystal and length part of these tracks. This scheme demonstrate how these tracks exist in olivine around epoxy. You see length, and solution can reach this track from both parts. So our estimation for etching ray is about 35 microns per hour. In these graphs, there are point which we receive from calibration and heavy iron accelerator, and of course we have not any calibration data for more heavy nuclei and for more higher etching rates. So we extrapolate this dependence for etching rate 35 and receive evaluation of charge this three nuclei like this one before between 105 and 130. The nuclei which I demonstrated previous slide, this one, we estimate charge using regression analysis. At the confidence level 95%, the nucleus charge with etching rate about 35 micron per hour is equal 119 plus 10 minus 6. Very, very important question about lifetime of such nuclei, because all nuclei which can create in the Earth in accelerator has lifetime 10 to the minus 6 second, maximum few minutes. Question is how such nuclei can reach meteorite. We made evaluation of lifetime for this nuclei, and we use next idea. To reach the solar system, all meteorites, we 99.9% of meteorite which we can investigate in the Earth are from как это называется, метеоритный пояс, belt, да. Вот, the solar system, asteroid belt. So to reach solar system and form track in meteorite, nuclei should have lifetime enough go from supernova up to asteroid belt. So this nuclei should have enough energy, first of all, and this nuclei should fly distance up to 5 kiloparsec from nearest supernova 1 kiloparsec and up to 8 kiloparsec. So estimation of minimum lifetime such nuclei which we registered in living crystal is from 3,000 up to 25,000 years. It is estimation of minimum lifetime of such nuclei. So, conclusion, we derived charge distribution more than 7,000 galactic nuclei with charge more than 55. We observed three events with very large charge estimation. This one, one of these nuclei has charge 119. Our evaluation of minimum lifetime of this nuclei is equal about 3,000 up to 25,000 years. So we derived additional indication of existence in nature of the stability Iceland elements. Thank you. And I would like again to wish new interesting results and best wishes to all participants meeting today. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Sorry, if I understand you right, you asked about etching process.
Is it safe for the
particle 1 million years ago on the.
Yes, yes, this certainly knows that such crystal can keep ancient track very, very long, and nobody knows nothing about changing parameters. So.
Known that for experts who working that such destruction areas, hidden damages exist forever. We don't hide it for development. This is convenient.
The checking is can we calibrate it, please?
Yes, of course, we calibrate it. We check very different ideas. For example, one of idea which we check. Is any connection between effect of canalirovanie with lens channeling effect with length of track, and we made special measurements, special calibration using region diffractometer, and answer no. Alevin has I demonstrate our photo from electronic microscope, very. Uniform structure, you see, hairline, very uniform structure. Now, in any direction, the track length will be the same. So, thank you. Coffee break.